Sunrise is indeed a song of two humans. The 1927 classic takes its viewers on a visual journey of love, pain, infidelity, heartbreak, remorse, healing, and love. Like a well-played rhythm and blues instrumental, the cinematography of Charles Rauscher and Carl Struss draws its audience into the deep emotions of Janet Gaynor's stellar performance as the wife of a man who falls into the arms of another woman and allows her to convince him to try to kill his wife. With the selective compositions and soft, low contrast black and white lighting in the wife's farmland setting, slightly higher contrast and busier frames in the mistress's wild city environment, and foggy surreal in between, F.W. Murnau's direction is visually well captured. Cinematographer Robert Yeoman, The Royal Tenenbaums, The Grand Budapest Hotel, in a TCM Spotlight interview about Sunrise, stated, "Since there was no sound in films of the silent era, cinematographers were very inventive with the use of the camera. In this case, the inventiveness lay primarily in the separation of the three settings through lighting and drawing in of the dramatic action through framing." The film's lighting tells the story of a grim and conniving mistress lurking in the shadows, plotting the opportunity to heartlessly steal from the innocent and distraught wife. The mistress is dressed in black clothes and a black hat and has a darker face lighting, making her appear more evil and, as like Maria put it in her Five Frames of Sunrise YouTube analysis, quote, snake-like. Whereas the wife's pale, well-lit face, blonde hair, and lighter clothing highlights her innocence and allows the audience to capture more of her emotions. The overall feel of the movie is mostly that of natural lighting, except during some of the flashbacks and montages, and during the second, more pleasant boat scene when the man and his wife are sailing home on the water for a second honeymoon. The blacks overall in the foggy field area where the infidelity takes place were not very dark, which makes the mistress and the water at night stand out more next to them. Shot composition and selective use of close-ups seem to be an even more significant creative contribution to the story than lighting. The shot where the man and the mistress first kiss is framed with him to the left and the mistress to the right, and is intercut with a shot of the wife and child at home with the baby to the left and the wife to the right. If these two shots were to be superimposed, the man and his wife would be in a position where they would be kissing each other. Instead, the two shots are composed, then edited together in a way that leaves viewers to feel the emotion of them not being together, rather, him with another woman while she is home with the baby. Once again, we're in a situation where the character that the director wants us most to empathize with is the wife. Therefore, she's the only one who gets the solo close-up. This is just one example of how each shot was meticulously planned. Other examples of this detailed shot planning and execution show in the superimpositions. Each superimposition seemed to be the result of well-thought-out match framing. Shot size is also intentional. For the first act of the movie, primarily wide and medium shots are shown, establishing the setup of the story. To illustrate the selective use of true close-ups of the film, there's a scene right at the apex of the first act of the movie where the husband wakes up and sees his wife feeding the chickens just outside the door. Superimpositions of the man imagining intimate moments with his mistress and the boat accident she suggested to get rid of his wife precede him walking over to his wife to invite her on a boat trip. Prior to this moment, it has been established that their relationship is strained. The first and only close-up of a person's face in the scene at this point is when the wife expresses happiness in response to the attention her husband gives her and his invitation. Now, during their conversation, a close-up of the man is not used. The decision to wait until this moment to show a close-up shot of the wife seems intentional and evokes empathy and sympathy for her. We know that the moment of happiness for her outweighs the despondence she's experienced. However, because we know he's been with another woman, we feel bad for her. The audience doesn't know that the husband has just invited her on the boat trip when her expression of joy begins. So at first, it feels like she's just happy to have his attention. The single close-up of the wife takes us more intimately to her perspective and afterwards keeps us drawn in with her as she grabs their baby from the nanny and spins around. A title card is what finally reveals the true source of her happiness, that she and her husband are going on a trip across the water. The collaborative use of cinematography and editing guides the emotion throughout the story's first act and continues to do so throughout the film. The next use of the true close-up is when the husband and wife are on the boat. This time, close-ups of both are used to bring the audience into the tension, lack of connection between the two, and ultimately the deceit and intimidation in his eyes and fear in hers. The boat trip seems to be the perfect time for close-ups of both, not only because of what the moment means, but also because of where they are and the isolation that naturally exists on a boat floating in a large body of water. The moment of realization of what the husband is trying to do as he menaces over her with crouched hands is broken up by the ringing of a bell. The director does use a close-up of the crouched hands to emphasize the man's maniacal state of mind, by the way. The ringing church bell becomes a theme throughout the sequence of scenes that follow, as we are intentionally guided from a wider perspective with the chase into the city. Camera angles track them from a near but not a super close distance, as showing the busy city background is symbolic and essential. Emotional journeys of both the husband and wife become important during the emotional roller coaster of her discovering that he wants to kill her, her going through a pit of total sadness and defeat, while he soaks in guilt and remorse. Eventually, they catch up to the source of the bell, a wedding happening nearby. A wide shot shows a couple from afar, walking up the stairs through the center of the wedding party into the church. The wide shots are used to establish the environment and the fact that this is someone else's wedding already happening. Again, no close-ups of what the director deems irrelevant to the story. Instead, the main characters, the man and his wife, follow the path of the bride and groom into the church. Inside the church, shots are strategically framed so as to make it more of their wedding than the wedding of those who are actually getting married. Medium close-ups and close-ups are used to isolate the two of them in the pew during the ceremony so that here the couple's relationship is rekindled through what is cinematically illustrated and choreographed to become their renewal of vows. The wide shot establishes the man and wife being separated from the wedding party by two large white columns. Additionally, the groomsmen make up the dark elements of the frame, matching the man, while the light parts of the frame, consisting of bridesmaids and the two columns, all match the woman. They go on their wild ride dance through the city in the manner we suppose the mistress had envisioned she and the man would. Fall in love again. Go on a honeymoon on a boat during which a storm causes the boat to actually tip over. The final shots of the movie summarize the mood the director leaves the audience with. A medium shot of the mistress rolling away backwards into the foggy night, and a bright close-up of the wife waking up to the sunrise and sharing an intimate kiss with her husband. An excellent progressive work of cinematography for an exhilarating story of forgiveness and rejuvenating requited love.